For all of you that are here tonight, journey to be with us together. Join us on live stream. Those of you who have joined us there, we're glad you're here. Some brethren have journeyed here all the way from Florida.
Yes.
To be with us. We're speaking from Missouri, so you just might know. We're in a Gospel of John. This will be our 66th exposition of this book. We're in the 5th chapter, verses 33 through 36. I call this a witness and a greater witness. You'll notice as we go through this section that accents a lot of what Jesus said. You should be picking up on the importance of an accurate understanding of who Jesus is. To gain the advantages that are offered to you in Christ Jesus, there must be a proper and accurate perception of who he is and what he does.
Yeah. Amen.
Some people have a lot of erroneous ideas about Jesus. And believe me when I tell you, Jesus does not work through erroneous ideas.
Amen.
In order to keep men enslaved to sin, Satan doesn't have to thrust them into moral depravity. He just has to distort their understanding of Christ. So he doesn't mind people going to church. He really doesn't. Being religious, even devout, but no objection, as long as they're wrong. Because he knows God never works for good through a lie.
That's right.
I know that sounds simple, but there's actually more there than meets the eye. So who Jesus is, what he's been appointed to do, he's not on a self mission. He's on a mission from God the Father. So it's important to know what that mission is, what God is targeting to accomplish in Christ Jesus. On these two matters, who Jesus is, what he's been sent and to do and is doing, you can't be wrong on these.
Yeah.
You can't.
That's right.
There's no leeway at all, no wiggle room. You've got to be right. Because God is the God of truth.
That's right.
Jesus is the truth. The gospel is the truth. See, so you've got to be right.
Amen.
So the Holy Spirit will come in. If you are wrong, but you have a good desire to know, the Holy Spirit will come in and correct this.
Yeah, if you've been exposed to the truth.
But I mean, that's just his objective.
Oh, yes.
He's not content with anyone being ignorant of who Jesus is.
Amen.
We're going to show that being ignorant of Jesus is really inexcusable. Some people say, well, people just misunderstand. Ah, that's too tame. That's too tame of a word. That's too weak. No. Not knowing about Jesus does not fall in the category of misunderstanding. It falls in the category of unbelief, ignorance, deception, darkness falls in that category. It isn't just that it's hard to understand and some people just don't get it. It's not that simple. All of the things connected with not seeing Jesus as he is and not understanding what he's doing, all of the things connected with that are from the devil.
Yeah.
None of them are innocent.
Uh-huh.
None of them are excusable. They can be forgiven if a person repents, of course. This is why because who Jesus is, what he's doing is such an extensive thing that all kind of titles have been ascribed to Jesus. See, in earth, if you get one title, that's really something. Some people spend thousands of dollars to get a couple of titles.
Yeah.
He has a port to the world, titles.
Yeah.
Jesus had a lot of titles. All of them are significant.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be probable just to name a few of them, Lord and Savior.
Mm-hmm.
No other person could get those two things together.
Right.
How about this, King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Or high priest, or blessed and only potentate, or mediator, or one making intercession, or a great shepherd, or the door, or the light of the world, or the vine, or the captain of salvation, or the author of eternal salvation, or the author and finisher of our faith, or the faithful witness. See, the reason for these different titles is the multifarious or many-faceted nature of salvation. Salvation involves all these kind of things.
Amen. Yes.
Salvation just isn't getting you out of a mud hole.
Yes. Amen.
Or helping you to quit drinking.
That's right.
If that's all you got, you can go to Alcoholics Anonymous.
Yes.
And they'll help you there. And if you want salvation, you got to do more than get out of trouble. You've got to get into something,
yes,
and participate in something.
Yeah.
And you're going to have an enormous amount of help to do it.
Amen.
And so that's the reason for all these different titles and descriptions given to Jesus. They're functions. They're not honorary, not honorary titles or emeritus. They're very, very real ministries.
Amen.
That's why they're there. See, salvation involves... Let's just name a few of the things. Deliverance from the devil. Deliverance from the world.
Mm-hmm.
Continual change. Regular cleansing. Fellowship with deity. That's a two-way.
Mm-hmm.
Interfacing with the household of faith, which is large and most of which have passed on. Judgment or discernment or comprehension, salvation involves that. Or matured thinking, thinking like a man, not thinking like a child. Be no children in understanding. That's what the King says.
Yeah.
Don't be children in understanding. Enough of this baby talk and baby understanding among people been in Christ for a while. Let's dispense with that. Childishness doesn't have any place. Mature thinking, disciplined living. Salvation includes coming out of sloppy living, ad hoc living, being caught in traps and snares all the time, being found in situations you wish you didn't get in. Salvation touches all that, and Jesus ministers in all of that. See, all that is under the great umbrella of salvation. So that's why it's important to know who Jesus is and what he's doing. Now here's our text, John 5:33-36. Jesus is still speaking to that group of people that objected to him healing a man on the Sabbath day. Ye sent unto John, and he bare witness unto the truth. That's John the Baptist. But I received not testimony from man. But these things I say that you might be saved. How's that? How's that for a word? Did you know that was in the Bible? These things I say unto you that you might... So you can't be saved without a word from Jesus. He, John, was a burning and a shining light, and you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me.
Amen.
So here's the arrangement. God has provided everything that's necessary for you to know who Jesus is and what Jesus has done, what Jesus is doing.
Amen.
If you don't know that, You've got to get that done before you die. You've got to come up to speed on this. If you're new in Christ, this is the way we all started out just like you did,
yes.
Not knowing very much. That's how you start out, but that's not where you stay.
Amen.
I know people have stayed there for decades, ever since I've known them, 50, 60 years. They've been in this infantile state where they hardly understand anything. See, God has not even provided a salvation that yields those kind of results.
Yeah.
Those results do not belong to God. They do not belong to Christ. That's not the status Jesus died for people to procure.
Amen.
All of that's out of order. It's out of order, totally out of order, to remain infantile. Oh, I suppose if a person was robbed of a good mind, all right, we can excuse that. God's merciful.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I've talked to people like that, and sometimes I think they're better off than some other people.
Mm-hmm.
They're most always happy people. You ever notice
Yeah.
that?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Almost always happy and pleasant people. Probably because they don't see all the stuff we see.
Mm-hmm.
Or we're excluding those kind of people that are what we call handicapped. We're excluding those. Now, Jesus said to these people, you sent to John. That sending he's talking about is mentioned in John 1:19. The Pharisees sent some people to John to find out who he was and what he was doing. And John gave a witness. Remember, John gave a witness. He said, I am not the Christ.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. I am not the Christ. They pressed him. They said, but are you Elijah?
Mm.
See, a member of the group I was identified with would never ask that question.
No.
They say John the Baptist was Elijah.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But what did he say? He said, no, I'm not John the Baptist. I'm not Elijah.
That's right.
And he spoke the truth.
Yes.
He's filled with the Holy Spirit. So somebody's wrong here, and it's not John.
Amen.
I'm not Elijah. No, he said, I'm not Elijah. Then they pressed him further and said, why are you baptizing then? He said, well, I'm the voice, not a voice. Some versions say a voice.
Uh-huh.
I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah, which is the Greek form of Isaiah. I'm the one Isaiah prophesied about.
Wow.
He said, behold, I'm going to send Elijah.
Uh-huh.
He's going to prepare the way of the Lord. That is to make people ready to receive Jesus. Jesus can't be received in a domain where no one knows anything about him.
Yeah, that's right.
Would the God people knew this.
Yeah.
This has escaped all kind of people.
Yeah.
They go in the middle of people who don't know anything about Jesus, and they preach Jesus. People don't have the faintest idea what they're talking about.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
John the Baptist was sent to make ready a people for the Lord. That's
yeah.
how the Bible puts it.
Yeah.
So he told the people who he was. There was no question about it. It may have seemed proper to them to go on examining Jesus of Nazareth like they did John the Baptist. He said, no. You've inquired about me already from the one person that knew. There's one person on the face of the earth that knew who I was and what I was here to do.
Yeah.
You went and asked him, he told you who I was. See, when men are exposed to the truth about Jesus and they fail to act upon it, it's not an innocent matter. They may say, well, I want to think about it for a while. How you know you're going to have a while? Who revealed to you was going to have a while to think about it? As soon as you know something is the truth, you've got to embrace it then. You can't be waiting. And every case in the scripture where there was a conversion, every single case was after the first time they heard.
Yes. Yeah. That's right.
From Pentecost on. First time, There's some people didn't, they heard it 1,000 times, didn't respond. So Jesus is plain about this matter about himself, whether you believe it or not. He that believeth not shall be damned.
Yeah.
That's what Jesus said. This is, these are his words. So it was, I don't like that kind of word. Let's tone it down. Tone it down. That should be ratcheted up.
Yeah, that's right.
Not toned down. He that believeth not shall be damned.
Yeah.
Paul said that they all might be damned who believe not the truth. In 2 Thessalonians 2:12. Toward the end of the first century, some of the last writings of Scripture, John said, 1 John 5:10, he that believeth not on the Son of God hath, he that believeth on the Son of God hath a witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar. Does anyone think that they're going to get by with that?
No.
Someone's a liar, it's not God.
That's right.
Amen.
Because he believed not the record God gave of his Son. See, that's how serious it is not to. Now, we're not talking about intellectual assent like you believe there was George Washington. We're not talking about that. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about you're persuaded of it and act upon it. Because someone that doesn't act upon it doesn't believe.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
So let's be clear to everyone that no person is free to reject Christ.
Amen.
No person. The person who doesn't accept Christ has been deceived.
Uh-huh.
That's what's happened.
Yeah.
Because if you don't believe, it opens the door for the great deceiver.
Yeah. Amen.
That's the door he enters into.
Yeah. When Jesus is standing there and you don't need faith to see him, everyone will be fully convinced.
Yeah, fully convinced.
But see, you're right. If they don't now, it's because something had to get in the way, right? Something.
See, it's just my private opinion. I think people aren't pressed to believe enough. From pulpits I'm talking about. We got too many counselors and mamby-pamby speakers in the pulpit. They need to get a legitimate job. That's what they need to do. I think people should be pressed to believe.
Yeah.
Amen.
Call upon the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
Yes.
To assist them. See, there's a person who doesn't respond to the message. It's not just that they just don't believe. They don't receive him either. If you don't believe on Christ, you can't receive Christ. If you don't receive Christ, you can't have life. You can't be a son of God. You are blessed of God. See, this is the way it is. So it's imperative to believe on Christ as he has been revealed, not somebody's perception of Christ.
Yeah.
He loves you very much. He understands just what you're going through and blah, 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 blah. He's got to be presented as God has presented him.
Yeah.
That's not how God has presented him.
Yeah, right.
He's presented him in such a way that you can connect him with salvation, with being freed from sin, freed from the snare of the devil, free from the dominion of the world. See, he's presented him so you'll get that idea that this is an escape from what inevitably leads to damnation.
Yes.
I've got to get out of that path.
Yeah.
And when you hear Christ, that's what Christ is.
Uh-huh.
That's what Christ is for. So these very people were questioning Jesus concerning what he said and what they'd heard, and they were balking at him. So he tells them, "You sent to John. John gave you a proper witness."
Mm-hmm.
Then he adds this word. I receive not testimony from man. John didn't prophesy for me.
Yeah, that's right.
I wasn't convinced I was a son of God because of John's testimony.
Yeah.
John testified for you,
amen.
Not for me. Well, it's important to see this. Other verses read, I do not receive testimony from man. I don't witness. the witness that I receive is not from man, New American Standard says. Not that I accept human testimony, the NIV says. I do not receive a mere human witness. The evidence which I accept on my behalf is not from man. So the witness I require doesn't come from man at all. The testimony that John gave was sufficient for the people. Mm-hmm. It wasn't sufficient for Christ. Mm-hmm. He had to have an affirmation from God himself.
Yes, amen.
And he got it.
Amen.
When he was baptized, the heavens opened, and the witness came down audibly.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. See? That's the witness that kept Jesus going.
Yeah.
In a sense, it's the same with you. Mm-hmm. Insightful people really know whether you're in or out. Mm-hmm. They can tell by your conduct. But their witness is not the witness you need. He that believeth on the Son of God, verses 1 John 5:10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself.
Yes,
see, that's the kind of witness that Jesus had. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of witness you've got to have. You've got to have a witness in yourself to where it's, if nobody's around at all,
uh-huh.
You've got the witness.
Amen.
Amen.
You say, how will I know? Well, we can't outline how you'll know. We can just tell you will.
Yeah.
You will know. If you cleave to Christ with purpose of heart, if that's what you do, you live by faith, you walk in the Spirit, you fellowship with Christ, God will get through to you.
Yeah.
To such an extent, you'll have confidence. I am the Lord's, and
yes.
He is mine. You'll have the witness in yourself. None of us can make it happen for the other person.
Right.
But it's our business to tell the people, he that believes on the Son hath the witness in himself. If you quiet down and won't stay where there's a noise of unbelief,
yeah.
You'll hear a still small voice saying, you belong to me.
Yeah.
That's all you need
yes.
to survive.
Yeah.
And you can survive. I say the... What a remarkable word. He says, I say these things that you might be saved. It almost looks like it doesn't fit in there, you know. I say these things that you might be saved. He said one time, I didn't come to condemn. That's not why I came. I came not to condemn the world, but that the world through me might be saved. But you have to, there's some things you got to hear.
Yeah, that's right.
Right? To be saved. Some things you got to hear. He's like, I say these things that you might be saved.
Mm-hmm.
I'm clearing up what I'm like.
Yes.
I'm clearing up who I am.
Uh-huh.
I'm making myself more perceptible to you so you can be saved.
Because
if you're going to be saved, you've got to see Christ.
Yeah. Amen.
If you're going to believe on him, you've got to perceive him. You have to know this is the Christ.
Yeah.
You've got to come to this conclusion.
Amen.
You can't, we shouldn't say that, have to say this, but you can't see him personally or this sort of thing. It's through the, it's, you hear him through the gospel.
Yeah.
He speaks through the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
It's a still small voice that undergirds the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
That only the people that believe the gospel hear this voice.
Yeah.
Nobody else hears it. And you can hear it. I say these things as you might be saved. That is, I'm speaking to you to put salvation within your grasp.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
See, it's possible being a condition you can't imagine that you could be saved. I mean, I've been in that state. I imagine you have too, that you just can't imagine you could be saved. Just, it looks so hopeless.
Yeah.
But Jesus can speak in such a way that it become aware to you, or cognizant to you,
yeah.
I can be saved.
Amen. Yes.
So a person, they've stumbled, and they've fallen, and they look like, I'm forever lost. I'm not going to get out of this. But Jesus can speak. I'm saying this so you can be saved.
Yeah.
You're going to be saved not by seeing your dilemma. You're going to be saved by seeing my salvation.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, you've got to see your dilemma. I understand that.
Yeah.
But that's not what saves you.
Yeah.
You're saved by when you see Christ as the Savior. I love that. I say these things unto you that you might be saved. Yes, Brother Jason.
Sir, I was just going to add to that that many of the people that Jesus said that to were actually his enemies at this point.
That's right.
So it just reminds us that Jesus came to save people who were his enemies.
That's right.
Yeah.
And this is the day of salvation. Christ is still, he's holding out this word to the whole world that's his enemy. I'm saying this, you might be saved. There's going to come a time when this door will be shut.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a wonderful word. Yes, Tony.
We believe on the testimony of the man who heard Jesus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But really, these things had to be said by the Lord first.
That's right.
Matter of fact, that's what the Hebrew writer says. They were first
spoken by the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's right.
And then they received the testimony.
They were confirmed
by the others. But see, Jesus, he didn't need confirmation. From men. So you send unto John, and he comments on John. He was a burning and a shining light. His witness wasn't sufficient for Jesus himself, but he will not relegate John to the background. He says he was a burning and shining light. His witness was sufficient for them to believe. That's what the point he's making. There was a blazing light.
Yeah.
That's what burning and shining light. It's a blazing light went out from John.
Yeah.
So anyone that heard him could believe on the Christ. Mm-hmm. It was that thorough of a message.
Yeah.
Amen.
They could believe on Christ. A bright, bright light. He, like other holy prophets, was sent from God. He wasn't a product of the Jewish teaching system. John the Baptist wasn't. See, some of the other scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees, Essenes, lawyers, they were all products of a Jewish teaching system. But John the Baptist wasn't. He went out in the wilderness. He went to school in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Away from the people.
Yeah.
God knew that if John's going to learn from me, he's got to get out of the schools.
Yeah.
Because they become corrupt. See, they become corrupt.
Yeah.
Brother Paul Saul of Tarsus was a product of that educational system, but he threw it all away.
He threw it all away.
In order to follow Christ and know him.
So both John and Paul ended up in the same, same condition.
Yeah.
Is like Moses. He was learned and eloquent in speech, Stephen says, in Egypt. But that all had to be boiled out of him out in the desert.
That's right.
Went out in the desert after 40 years out there. He said, I can't speak good. Stephen said he was eloquent.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But that's Egypt will take it out of you. The wilderness will take Egypt out of you.
That's right.
I know from experience. I know this from experience. I'm not just speculating. I know that when you get isolated from the organization, there's some stuff you finally get rid of.
Yeah,
thank God you finally get rid of it.
And there's some stuff you get.
Yes, right.
Yeah.
So John the Baptist, he was like the other prophets. He got his message from God, not from the deductions of other people. A valid distinguishing message distances you from the class of average and mediocre. Someone who delivers the unique and effective message of God cannot be considered a member of the normal class of preachers and teachers. Now, I've been around both kinds of people. And I've noticed that the people that are around the official status classes always have secondhand knowledge. They very rarely get an original thought. In fact, one man told me one time, it's impossible for you to have an original thought. Yeah, what he told me. I said, well, that just shows how much you know. Pretty close to zero.
I guess if you say it's from the Lord, it's not original to you, but it's from the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, it's an original human experience, yeah. Now, worldly credentials do not validate a messenger from God. There was a time when I thought they did, but they don't. They don't validate a messenger from God. It'd be good if messengers from God were validated like, say, Timothy. This is written of Timothy, which is well reported of by the brethren that were in Lystra and Iconium. They noted this young man. I was this kind of person. When I was ordained, I was commended by Christian people that knew me at my ordination service. That's right. I was ordained before I was trained. That's the way with Timothy.
Yeah.
See, this, if you're a young person, you're under 30, or maybe you're in your teens, you conduct your life so godly people treasure you and see you a lot of potential in you.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't be like a normal kid, as they say.
Yeah.
Purge yourself from teenage jargon and talking like this questionable young people of the day. Purge yourself from that kind of stuff. It has no place in the body of Christ.
Yeah,
any more than old people using old folks' language. You know what I'm saying? If you're going to work for God, you've got to have the approval of God's people.
Amen.
So John the Baptist was totally outside the ordinary class of Jewish teachers. And it took someone like that to properly introduce Jesus. Because he hadn't formulated private ideas, see. Now he was a burning and shining light. Other versions read the burning and shining lamp, the lamp that was burning and shining. Most versions omit the article the, and they say a. I have nine Greek versions. They all use the article the. I don't know why they said a, but I don't like it. He was the, in other words, there wasn't anybody else like John. He was a lone star at the time. There wasn't anybody else like him that was prepared to make him a way ready for Christ. There wasn't anybody else like that. He was, if you want to know about Jesus, you had to go to John.
Yeah.
You said, well, they could have studied the prophets. Yeah, but they had to have someone to tell them what the prophets are talking about. And the prophets talked about John, foretold him. Burning and shining light. And you, you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. I mean, it was novel. He was a different kind of preacher. He's a fireball preacher, you know. He didn't talk like the scribes did. He didn't teach like them. He was a breath of fresh air, John was. Oh, it was good to hear that fiery preacher. I can't stand dull preachers. I don't know about other. I don't sit in judgment on them. But I can remember when I can remember his name, George Stansberry. He was a fiery preacher. Boy, when I heard him, I said, whoo, it fired me up. John the Baptist was that kind of man.
Amen.
He was a fiery speaker. And it was good at first. They liked it for a while. They're willing to hear him for a time. But pretty soon, I mean, this thing about repentance and bringing forth fruits meet for repentance, that kind of got the old. Pretty soon the people were saying, he's got a demon. That's recorded in Matthew 11:18. That's what they were saying about the people who went to hear him.
Yeah.
You were willing to listen to him for a while, for a season. See, he was to get people ready to believe on Christ. Mm-hmm. But the people that listened for us, he said they missed that.
Yeah.
They thought this was the kind of the main thing. But John wasn't the main feature. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. John's light, you were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. His light was a message.
Yeah.
That's what it was, a message. They could well have joined Paul in the affirmation, we preach not ourselves. See?
Yeah.
And let me cite a few things that John the Baptist said about Jesus. You've heard him as the Lamb of God. He that comes after me. See, so he knew he wasn't going to be around. He comes after me. A man which is preferred before me. He said of Jesus, whose shoe latchet I'm not worthy to unloose. He that cometh after me is mightier than I. He who shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. I baptize you with water, he said. And he whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor. That's some things he said about Jesus.
Yeah.
These people probably heard him say those things.
Yeah. Amen.
But they were questioning who Jesus was. So these people he's addressing could bear that kind of message, like I told you some of the things he said, for a while. But it was so unlike their persons and objectives that they finally didn't want to listen anymore. But God was not indifferent to their response.
Yeah, that's right.
We've met people like this. You've met people like this. They really were, as they say, excited about what you were saying.
Yeah.
For a while.
Yeah, for a while.
For a while. And it got kind of old to him.
Yeah.
God notes that. He notes that.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Jesus talked about those who believe for a while, Luke 8:13, but have no root in themselves, and in time of temptation, fall away.
Yeah, that's right.
Lo and behold, they were coming to church, as they say. They were listening. They were really enthused.
Yeah,
they
maybe
even tithed. But pretty soon, whoa, they fell off into sin. What happened? They were just willing for a while. Just for a while. So don't be one of those for a while people. Have no root.
Amen.
The Word of God doesn't produce that kind of people. It doesn't produce for a while. People. For a while, people are not rooted and grounded.
Yeah.
They're tossed to and fro.
That's right.
Every wind of doctrine. They always like to read the latest books and see the latest movies and hear the latest song. And they're always those kind of people tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men. See, men pick up on people like this. They make millions of dollars on people like this.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, they do.
Oh, yeah.
They exploit them. There's some people that made more last week than this accumulated people who are making a lifetime.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Off of Christian people.
Yeah.
Because they weren't rooted and grounded. So institutionalism and shallow preaching produces for a while Christians. People who do not go on to perfection. They don't perfect holiness in the fear of the Lord. They don't grow up into Christ in all things. They don't grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, because those things can't be accomplished in a while.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. So that's John's witness. Jesus said, you heard it. He was a burning . That means the wick wasn't going out. Remember the five foolish virgins, their lamps went out.
That's right.
John's lamp didn't go out.
That's right.
Was burning bright.
Which implies, if not directly says, that he never did doubt who Jesus
That's
was.
That's right.
John didn't like sit there in prison and go, I wonder if he really was.
Yeah.
His light didn't go out.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that incident where he sent his disciples and ask if Jesus was the Christ, everyone must understand he wasn't asking for himself.
Yeah, that's right.
He knew his ministry was about over.
Uh-huh.
And his disciples had to be leaving him and following Christ. That's what they were supposed to. They should have done it already. They should have, a long time ago, they should have left John and followed Christ. But John and Jesus were preaching simultaneously. There were still people following John. And some of them had been following him from day one. But those that really believed on Christ left him, like Philip and John left him, followed Christ. So that's what John was inducing them to follow Christ.
Yes.
But right after that, Jesus said, what did you go out, when you went to see John, did you go out to see a reed shaking in the wind? Is that what you expected? Did you see some vacillating guy like people represent him today?
Yeah.
I have a greater witness than that of John. Remember, he said earlier in his dissertation, he said, John bore witness of me, but there's another witness. Now he's going to go back to that. I have a greater witness than that of John. Before, he said it was the Father. So he had John as a witness, the Father as a witness. Now he says, I've got another one. I'm going to introduce witness number three. For the works of the Father hath given me to finish the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father sent me. See, now we got three witnesses.
Yeah.
John the Baptist, God the Father, and what Jesus did.
Yeah, amen.
Three witnesses. That's a greater witness than John.
Yeah.
If you see what I'm doing, that's a greater witness than believe me when I tell you, if you're not living out the faith, you're a big inhibition to people. If your life contradicts the doctrine, you are an obstacle.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
Just as surely as Jesus would be if his works were feeble works. Uh-huh. See, his works, my works tell you who I am, and your works tell people who you are.
Yes.
And my works tell people who I am.
Yes. Uh-huh.
You shall know them by their works.
Amen.
By the fruits. The greater witness, it doesn't make Jesus greater. He's not a greater Christ because of the greater witness. It's just it confirms who he really is. What I am doing confirms who I really am. When I say, pick up your bed and walk, that's me that said that.
Yeah, that's right.
That tells you the kind of power Jesus is saying I have.
Yeah.
When I say to leopards, be clean. I say to a storm, be still. That's me.
Yeah.
That's the kind of power I have. Do you think you can have some circumstance in life that will baffle Jesus?
No.
Well, you won't.
That's right.
Our job is to persuade people of that.
Yes.
To persuade people. No, Jesus is equal to whatever. It may stymie you.
Uh-huh.
It may confound people around you.
Yes.
No one may be able to diagnose the situation, but that's not Jesus. He's not in that class. My works, they confirm who he really is. There's more than enough evidence for everyone who has an honest and good heart, and that's in that order, honest and good. There's more than enough evidence to convince people not only that Jesus is the Christ, but that they should trust him and live for him.
Yeah.
There's more than ample evidence for that to take place.
Amen.
I have greater witness than John. The works, I tell you, this is powerful. The same works that I do bear witness of me, that the Father has sent me. These are the kind of works nobody else has ever done.
Yes.
Particularly on this scale. For instance, until Jesus, there was never one time a man born blind that was made to see.
Uh-huh.
4,000 years of human history, there never was one time a blind man that was made to see. Jesus healed several of them.
Yeah.
Amen.
The works, now I didn't say work. The works the Father hath given me to finish. These are the works now that bear witness of him. Now the bottom line, if you sum up all the works, the bottom line is lay down your life and take it up again. That's kind of the bottom summation. But the works that he was doing all led up to that. In other words, as Jesus went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, he was blessing men, it was preparing him. Yeah. He was experiencing the influx of divine power. He was experiencing divine fellowship. See, he was experiencing divine approval. He's going to have this when he lays down his life. There can't be any question about if God be for us. See, you can't be any question about that. So during his ministry, he did these things more for him than for men.
Amen.
They were bearing witness of him, who he really was. Well, what are some of the works of Jesus? Well, let's name some of them here. Preach the gospel to the poor. Heal the brokenhearted. Have you had a try at that yet? Have any of our charismatic brethren done that? Has anyone reported they healed someone a broken heart? Huh? The wonder workers, have they done that? Jesus did.
Amen.
Preach deliverance to the captives. That's announce it, not cause it. Announce it. Recovering the sight of the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Bruised means in shackles. Preach the acceptable year of the Lord. He declared it. He didn't say there's an acceptable year coming. He says it's here.
Yeah.
Going about doing good, healing all who are oppressed of the devil. He was sent to finish the work. John 4:34. Sent to finish the work. His mission included seeking and saving the lost, fulfilling the law and the prophets, to cause variance and division. Don't think I've came to bring peace. I came to bring division. It's going to be five in a household, three will be against two. Son will be against father, father against son, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law. See, you see, did Jesus come to do that? Well, that's what he said.
Amen.
What it was is there were two different kind of people.
That's right.
Nobody could tell until Jesus came.
Yes, that's right.
Amen.
He made distinction who was who.
Yeah.
Amen.
Tare, wheat.
Yes.
He came to do that, see, because it's hard to tell until Jesus came. It was hard to tell. Nobody suspected the Pharisees or what they really were, but when Jesus came, he made that division. I came to send fire on the earth, burn up everything that's combustible, and for distinguishing judgment. For judgment, I've come into the world, see, to tell the way things really are. Now, frequently, Jesus was referred to as works, particularly those he did when he moved in and out among men. They're called mighty works.
Yeah.
As to divine might, divine power. They were works that it took God's power to do. They were not works that could be accomplished by human ingenuity or human training or human regimen. They weren't those kind of works. He said of his works, I must work the works of him that sent me while it's day. See, there's going to come a time when the night's going to descend. And I'm going to have to lay down my life and I'm not going to be working any more on earth. See? So I must do the works. You must have this kind of resolve. You yourself must have this kind of resolve. I must work the works of him that sent me while it's day. While you're able to see, while you're able to discern, when you know what's right and wrong, work.
Yeah.
Do the work of Christ we're talking about. The Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. What he said. John 14:10. The Father dwells in me. He wouldn't even take credit himself.
That's right.
Father dwells in me. He does the work. So this shouldn't be too hard for us to say, should it? I mean, if the captain of our salvation can say this, we should not have any trouble saying it. These works were so potent. Here's what he said about them. If I do not the works of my Father, believe me not, but if I do, though ye believe me not, believe the works.
Yeah.
got it. That's potent now.
Yeah.
If you don't believe on me personally, just see what I've done and believe that.
Amen.
Believe the works that ye may know. It's refreshing to confess from time to time, it was the Lord.
Yeah.
It wasn't a plan.
Yeah.
It wasn't a strategy.
Yeah.
It was the Lord.
Amen.
Believe the works.
Yeah.
When you see God does something, don't try and find a carnal explanation for it. Believe the works.
Amen.
Believe the works.
Amen.
John 15:24, here's what he said. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did.
Yeah.
Now it's well past time, brethren, that in the professed church people see some works that nobody else has ever done.
Yeah. Amen.
It's time. It's time for those to be seen. I did things no one else ever did these things. And changed lives, regenerated lives, new lives, walk in newness of life. There is nothing that man can do that can accomplish these things. So it's time to put them on display. Yes.
On the other hand, what you were talking about, when you see God's works, don't think of a carnal explanation for it. But the brethren should be on the offensive that whenever we hear those carnal explanations for things, that we bring the work of God to bear.
That's good.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
And it is, you notice how refreshing it is when you connect the works with God, it refreshes your spirit.
Yeah.
Now this is all Jesus is saying. He's the only answer to the dilemma caused by sin.
Yeah.
All human dilemma, all of it, has been caused by sin.
Yeah, that's right.
And Jesus laid the axe to the root of the tree of sin.
Yes.
He took it away. He actually did. Now, as it's necessary to hear to say a word about the work of Jesus in salvation, in him there is really a new creation.
Yes.
This just isn't a Sunday school lesson. There is a new creation. There's deliverance from this present evil world so that it doesn't dominate a person.
Yes.
There's life more abundant. There's true freedom. If the Son make you free, you're free indeed. There's the ability to do all things through Christ who strengtheneth us. See? There's peace that passes understanding. There's grace reigning through righteousness. There's fruits of righteousness.
Yeah.
There's a supply of all our need, to name a few things. These are what salvation produces. However, if these works are not made apparent in God's people, you can't deduce them. They've got to be lived out.
Amen.
That's a burning and shining light.
Yeah.
Ye are the light of the world.
That's right.
It doesn't say you should be. We're called to be light, called to be salt. See, this is just theological jargon.
Yeah.
That's not what Jesus said.
Amen.
He didn't say we ought to be light, we ought to be salt. That's not what he said.
Mm-hmm.
That's the kind of people he produces.
Yes.
He produces people that illuminate and people that preserve and
Amen.
People that deliver savor, a true savor to life.
Yeah.
Jesus, this is what he does.
Yeah.
Amen. And that's your witness. Your witness to the world of the validity of Christ is your life.
Yes, amen.
You are, as Paul said, an epistle, the epistle of Christ.
Yeah.
You're Christ's letter
uh-huh.
to the world.
Yes.
That tells the world what Jesus does.
Amen.
Don't be ashamed of it.
Yes.
I don't think anyone here is, but Satan will tempt you
yeah.
to put your light under a bushel.
Uh-huh.
But It's not a good thing. It'll go out. Lights don't continue to burn under the bosom.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, for these evidences to be lacking in professing believers would be like a blind man that Jesus healed having to wear glasses. It'd be like a leper that Jesus healed still having some leprosy on his arm. Be like a lame man had to still walk with crutches. Uh-huh. That would belie what Jesus said he did. Uh-huh. An unholy life, whoever lives it, an unholy life belies what Jesus as Savior.
Yeah.
It's testifying to people this is a lot of malarkey.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of unbelief in the world is traced to a weak church.
Yes, amen.
She's the mother of the abominations of the earth. That's what the Revelator was told. So, in your measure, you have witnesses too. God bears witness, the Spirit bears witness with your spirit. The Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. All right, there's a witness. Then the Word of God confirms by describing what this
yes.
new life does. It confirms you there's another witness. Mm-hmm. And then your works, mm-hmm. the effect they have on you, so that's another witness.
That's right.
So you've got multiple witnesses too.
Amen.
If you live like you can in Christ,
uh-huh.
and you'll have confidence, mm-hmm. you'll have assurance, mm-hmm. see? You'll not be baffled by life. You'll not be unstable,
yeah.
which none of us want to be like this.
Right.
But even the best of us will have periods where we say, whoa,
yeah.
I'm not in heaven yet.
Yeah, that's right.
Where you're just kind of thrown off course. All right, the answer to that is get back on course.
Amen.
That's right.
You've got,
yes.
if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Son.
Yes.
He can seal your heart, give you that confidence and assurance again. Come boldly to the throne of all grace. Mm-hmm. Find mercy and grace to help in the time of need. See, all the provisions are there.
Mm-hmm.
He's opened up a way.
Mm-hmm.
It's a new and a living way, right into the throne room.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone here, if you're in Christ, you've got multiple witnesses. If you listen to them,
yes.
during your best, during your worst day, you'll survive.
Yes.
Yes, amen.
All right, anyone else have anything before?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Sometimes it might take it minute by minute.
That's right.
But you just keep thinking about the promises. And
that's right.
And then it'll just increase. You won't have to go. I mean, yes, you need the Lord every minute, but you know what I'm saying.
Oh, yes.
So just to get through another minute, Lord, help
now, you
me.
Don't have to spend
help
your
me.
Lifetime bobbing up and down in the sea, but
yes,
you may have to spend
right.
a day and a night out
that's
there.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah, before Jesus came, God sent one burning and shining
that's
light.
Right.
Since Jesus has ascended into
yeah,
heaven, he has many burning and shining
that's
lights.
Right.
That's a whole army, like I said.
A city.
Yeah, on
it's
a
like
hill.
A city set
Amen.
On a hill.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, Sister Melissa.
I understand the scripture even better now. I always used to have a question about the Spirit bearing witness
yeah.
with your spirit that you are sons of God, which already I understood it now, but
yeah.
You made it even more clear
yeah.
because these works.
Mm.
So as we, as the Lord reveals to us different things, as we walk by faith
yeah.
and we see things by faith, that these works bear witness with us.
Mm-hmm.
So they're preparing us for glory.
That's right.
Just like Jesus was being
That's right.
prepared. So
mm-hmm.
we're being prepared through these things, the Spirit bearing witness with us, that it prepares us for all the trials, all the
there
things.
You go.
It's giving us the transformation. It's part of our transformation.
That's right. That's right. Now, some, when the Spirit bears witness with your spirit, it might seem to you like this is a conclusion. This that you have drawn a conclusion. But really, it's a spirit birth. See, because you know it's got to be more than that because it's outside the circumference of human experience.
Yeah.
See, it's something that's bigger
yeah.
than men are capable of. So when you receive this assurance, this full assurance of faith,
yeah.
is because the Holy Spirit is born witness.
Yeah.
That's why you got that. Uh-huh. Yes, Brother Judah.
About the same train of thought as Brother Bob was. John was the voice, mm-hmm. singular, crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord by way of preparation. He prepared the way, and then Jesus came, and now we are the fulfillment of what John came to prepare.
That's yeah. right.
So now John was the voice in preparation. Now we have a voice for fulfillment.
That's right. Yeah.
So think uh-huh. about how much noise your own voice by yourself, how much noise that can make. And then compare that to a multitude shouting together with one voice.
Yeah.
How much more potent that sound is
Amen.
Than you're talking by yourself.
Amen.
And that's what's happening for Christ now, is those who have been saved by Jesus, who John came to prepare the way yeah. for, we're a living testimony to the world, and it's one voice shouting together.
Yeah.
It's not, this thing has not been done in a corner, is what Paul said.
Uh-huh.
This joint testimony is pictured several ways. One is it's pictured as all diffusing light, the abundance of light. Another is an epistle of Christ, not a word or a page,
yeah.
an epistle
yeah, that's right.
of Christ.
Uh-huh.
And it's it's this multitude. Uh-huh. It's an incense.
Yeah. Amen.
In the world, there's an incense that's rising up
yeah.
from all over. Sometimes some incense that originated in Rhodesia. You pick up on it, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, you hear somebody, you hear somebody's got some incense way over Uganda. But it's a joint thing going up.
Yes.
Anyone else tonight? All right, Mr. Barb.